welcome to Wide Angle this week. We have just entered an election year in India. Now, traditionally, wisdom says that foreign policy doesn't really play a role in any election campaign. But we've seen lots of ups and downs in the neighborhood with Pakistan, with China. We've also seen a security situation in Kashmir spiral out of hand. So to talk to us about how these will factor into the election campaign, we have with us former Foreign Secretary Ambassador Shyam Saran. Thank you so much for giving us some of your time. So, sir, without further ado, I want to actually ask you straight off the bat, in your experience, has foreign policy ever played a significant role in winning or losing an election?
It depends really on the context. For the forthcoming elections, what I fear is that there will be a temptation, at least on the part of the ruling party, to try and focus attention again on Pakistan. As you recall, it did during the Gujarat elections. So whether or not there will be a temptation once again to bring the relationship with Pakistan into the election campaign, for example, playing up the surgical strikes or other important moves that India has made against Pakistan successfully. These are things which may come up in the election campaign. So there is a precedent that sometimes.
But nonetheless, on Pakistan, there's also a sense that in the last now almost 5 years of this government, starting from the swearing in of Prime Minister Modi on 26 May 2014, when he invited SAARC leaders, Nawaz Sharif came. There have been so many U-turns and flip-flops on the Pakistan policy that many of us actually ask whether there is a Pakistan policy.
Well, I think you have to look at how this has evolved. There is no doubt that the Prime Minister, to begin with, did what other Prime Ministers have also attempted, which is to try and see whether, if not a friendly relationship with Pakistan, at least a workable kind of relationship with Pakistan can be established. Because I think successive prime ministers have realized that Pakistan can become a rather big distraction from the other important things that India wishes to do, both in the rest of the neighborhood as well as in the region and in the world. So I can't fault him for that he made, I think, despite the rhetoric during the election campaigns, he made a very significant move to try and improve relations with Pakistan. And despite setbacks, he kept
trying,
including going to Lahore on that very highly publicized visit. But I think what we have seen is a repeat of the earlier stories. That is, every time there has been an effort to try and improve relations, there have been very important constituencies in Pakistan, the Pakistani army, the intelligence agency, which has felt threatened. And we have had an uptick in terrorist incidents, and domestic politics will not permit a prime minister in the face of these kind of attacks to continue with such an initiative. So we are now in the phase of, well, we tried, it didn't work. Now we have to be very tough. We have to have a harsh policy. We have to try and isolate Pakistan. All this is quite understandable. But I think what we are seeing today is that, having done this, after this, what? I mean, if you have escalating violence at the border, where do you want this to lead to? So that is not very clear.
Also, on the issue of isolating Pakistan internationally, at every fora, Indian foreign policy has put forth its own analysis and experience of Pakistan's support to terrorist groups that infiltrate and perpetrate acts of violence on Indian soil. So, in a sense, in a political environment which is also highly charged, where there are tensions building up between communities in the country as well, the sense is, go to Pakistan has become this thing you say to your political opponent as well today. But that's an aside. The question is, when nothing has worked, or when you say, okay, what next, then you have a Kartarpur initiative. Now, you know, what is the message you're sending out then? Do you want peace? Do you not want engagement? Do you want to be tough? If so, how does Kartarpur fit into that?
Well, I think Kartarpur is an example of where we were put on the defensive. And we were put on the defensive because of domestic political factors. Because not agreeing to Kartarpur corridor would have cost in terms of local votes in Punjab. I mean, that's the simple, straightforward explanation. And having therefore started with a sort of a tough line, eventually you had to change because, you know, domestic political opinion in fact pushed you in that direction. So this is another example of where domestic factors play an important part in foreign policy decisions. So need not necessarily be very consistent or very logical, but let me say that this is a personal opinion that despite the fraught relationship between India and Pakistan, a change of government in Pakistan still provides a opportunity which should be explored, you know, whether or not some change in the relationship is possible. Maybe it will not be possible, but I see a certain, you know, opening that perhaps we should explore, if nothing else. The reason why I say that is that there is a change with respect to Pakistan's own, you know, international position. You know, since the 1950s, Pakistan has had two major pillars for its foreign policy posture. One is the alliance with the United States of America, and the other with China. And despite the fact that there have been periods of great tension between the US and China, the one point of consensus between them has been support for Pakistan.
Right.
China has never objected to US support for Pakistan, in fact has encouraged the US to offer greater support to Pakistan. And similarly, you will never find that the United States of America has been rather concerned about, you know, an increase in Chinese influence in Pakistan. What has changed now? At least the American pillar has become very shaky.
That's right.
With Trump.
The South
it
Asia
started
policy.
Even with the in the last years of Bush, because that was the first time that they actually started having anti-terrorist operations within the territory of Pakistan, which they had not done before. But since then, there has been an acceleration in that process under Trump. So one of the pillars has become very shaky.
Right.
And the dependence on China has become, therefore, much more acute than it has been in the past.
Okay.
And this is causing, to my mind, causing some discomfort in Pakistan, including in the Pakistan military. So they are trying to also see how they can, you know, increase their room for maneuver. And in that context, is there an opportunity for India? I would say worth exploring.
All right. So now that you've brought us to this issue of the two pillars that support Pakistan, the US and China, what about India's relationship with the two pillars that support Pakistan today? Because while, you know, Donald Trump has been extremely vocal about cutting off aid to Pakistan and, you know, the lack of sort of any room for Pakistan to maneuver in the Trump administration with his South Asia policy, it doesn't necessarily mean it's a win for India.
No, it may not be a win necessarily for India. But if I look at the scene today, you know, if you compare US relations with India, say compared to US relations with its own allies, we are comparatively speaking in a somewhat better place.
It's a great honor to be with you, Mr. Prime Minister. Thank you. Thank you very much.
मुझे खुशी है कि राष्ट्रपति ट्रंप के साथ फिर एक बार मुझे मिलने का मौका मिला है भारत और अमेरिका के संबंध बहुत तेजी से गहरे और व्यापक हो रहे हैं
इफ यू लुक एट द स्ट्रेटेजिक अंडरपिनिंग्स ऑफ द रिलेशनशिप particularly on the defense side, particularly on the counter-terrorism side, these two important components of the relationship have actually been consolidated and have been further, you know, progressed. So there has not been a problem in terms of that part of the relationship. Where you can say that there is still a question mark is the economic and trade relationship. Mm. But the economic and trade relationship, virtually every other country is facing that uncertainty. Problems, right. So it's not that we are in some kind of a more vulnerable position compared to the others. So that is a plus point in terms of the relationship.
In fact, could you argue because we have our own views on strategic autonomy, we might be less vulnerable than some of the allies?
I certainly think so, because I know that there are people who have been criticizing non-alignment, criticizing strategic autonomy. Frankly speaking, I see strategic autonomy as a running theme ever since India became independent. Mm-hmm. And having that room for maneuver for yourself as a major power, I think it is very important for India. So, India having maintained this relationship with the United States, despite the uncertainties which Trump brings to this relationship, and what this does in terms of our relationship with China, our ability to have a better sort of understanding with China, because China is perhaps more affected by this very negative turn in US-China relationship than perhaps many people realize. And I think China is certainly looking to see how it can at least protect its other flanks while it is having to deal with this new adversarial kind of relationship with the United States. So in that context, you will see that China is at least rhetorically, at least optically, is being more reasonable in its relationship with India than it has been before. And I think we should leverage that opportunity.
How would India leverage that opportunity with China?
I don't think we can expect very major changes, but we are already seeing some degree of tranquility at the border, for example. You know, the provocations at the border have perhaps, from what I understand.
Although we've seen at least a year and a half of tensions along the border,
so
if not
if
more.
If you compare the current situation with what led up to Doklam, there is no doubt that there is a much more, as I said, tranquil and peaceful situation on the border than it has been before. And I do link it to China being much more amenable or maybe a little more sensitive to Indian concerns than it has been in the past. And that is linked to the pressures that it is facing vis-a-vis the United States of America. So let's not make too much of it, because I think this is really just giving us some space at the margin and may very well change if tomorrow the relationship with the United States of America changes. But at this point of time, if we have that space available to us, Indian foreign policy would be well advised to take advantage of that.
So, a couple of related questions to that. One is, because it's an election year, we're asking this question about how much of a role foreign policy will play in an election campaign. And that's a very specific question. But other than that, in an election year, what are the goals or the benchmarks that diplomats and the bureaucracy can set for the foreign policy vision this year? Or is everything in sort of suspension because, you know, we don't know who will come to power in May 2019, and while there is conventional wisdom that says foreign policy follows a path of continuity, we've also seen populist leaders bring breaks to that continuity.
Well, I mean, there will be, obviously, if there is a change in government, there will be some departures. Even if the BJP comes back to power, perhaps it may decide to deal with foreign policy issues somewhat differently than it did in the first term. We saw that in the difference between UPA 1
and
UPA
2.
Despite the fact that you had the same prime minister. So that is quite natural. But I still believe that major departures in foreign policy as a result of elections are probably not possible. Because, the frame within which you are formulating and executing foreign policy, that frame does not really change very much in the short run. So this is probably the stage, I imagine, where BJP perhaps is looking at, okay, in my manifesto, what place is foreign policy going to have? How am I going to project what the policy of the new BJP government would be? What are the unfinished tasks we are now committed to, for example, fulfill? What are some of the new initiatives we are going to take? And similarly, I would think that the Congress party is doing something similar. You know, what is it that we want to project forward? For example, would a Congress government be looking much more favorably on, say, the SARC initiative? You know, does it agree with what the BJP government is saying, that no, SARC really is not very relevant anymore? Let us focus attention more on BIMSTEC. Let us focus attention on BBIN. Let Pakistan, you know, be isolated as far as regional cooperation is concerned. Does the Congress agree with that approach? You know, so there will be some changes.
So is it fair to say that from a change in political dispensation, historically, I'm not talking only about now, that on the foreign policy front, especially with equations with, you know, the big equations, US, China, Russia, perhaps even Pakistan, that there's much more continuity along that track, but on regional issues and regional partnerships or sub-regional alliances, that's where individual leaders might actually leave their mark on policy?
Well, you know, the attitude towards regional cooperation, as I pointed out, is in a sense derived from our Pakistan policy.
Correct.
Or what is being projected as Pakistan policy. I happen to believe that, you know, we should not give up the SARC approach, because keeping Pakistan out and saying we will go ahead without Pakistan is really admitting that you cannot handle Pakistan, you know. And I don't think that is a right approach to take. But what I was trying to point out was that as far as major, influences or drivers of India's foreign policy are concerned, those are well known in terms of the regional situation which we face, the kind of relationships that we have with, say, the United States or with China, with the region itself, Southeast Asia, Japan. All these are fairly predictable components in the policy. But at the same time, I think we have to realize that we are living in what I would call an age of disruption, in the sense that the overall global context is transforming very, very rapidly, partly because of the uncertainty that is brought in by somebody like Trump, but it is not just Trump. There are major changes that are taking place in the global landscape because power relations are changing, because technology is bringing about changes. So we have to take those into account. It is likely that we will continue to face in the coming year, in fact, more changes with regard to the global landscape. And if these changes continue to take place and even accelerate, then any government here will have to deal with a changing landscape.
And yet in this age of disruption, the US president has proven to be one of the biggest contributors to the disruption and disruptor himself.
Certainly.
What does that mean for us vis-a-vis Pakistan, vis-a-vis Afghanistan? So, I mean, you know, his comment about the library didn't go down well. Everyone's asking what library he actually was referring to. But the fact is, you know, it's this position from Washington that says, we are the biggest country in the world, and yet we're not going to be there for anybody else. You guys are left to your own devices. Whether it's India, who welcomes this kind of independence and wants it and seeks it, or even smaller countries which have been dependent on the US for their security. Afghanistan is extremely concerned about Donald Trump's comments, for example.
So I think, one, we should be somewhat careful in not believing that every tweet is leading to the threatened action, because as you have seen with regard to Syria, you had a follow-up statement from other members of the administration.
That's right.
You have Bolton, for example. If you look at his statement, the fact that even troops are being withdrawn, we hear that very large number of contractors are going to be staying on, fulfilling virtually the similar kind of role. So I think we have to also be careful in not over-interpreting some of these actions by Trump. But what we do have to recognize is that long term, there is no doubt that relatively speaking, the presence of the United States and its influence on regional theaters is diminishing. And therefore, Not so much in terms of Indian foreign policy reacting to every tweet or reacting to every sudden development which is taking place, but recognizing that in this period of change, we have to be placed in a way that we can not only cope with these changes, but also, I have said several times, that periods of change are also periods of opportunity. Because when things are frozen, then there is very little room for you to really advance your interests as well.
So on this issue of change and disruption, I mean, in the last couple of years with the United States and rising tensions, leave aside China and Pakistan right now, but with Iran and Russia and how those have impacted India's independent ties with both these countries on trade, on defense agreements, on oil imports, on what have you. The Iranian foreign minister was in Delhi recently and he made two comments. One is that we are now living in a post-Western world, that we can't take what the United States does or says very seriously. The world has moved on. But the second was an appeal of sorts to India to ensure that its foreign policy does not sort of fall prey or become hostage to what's coming out of Washington.
I think he is being unfair because I don't think that India has allowed its foreign policy to be hostage to the United States. In fact, I think India has done rather well that, you know, it has been able to...
I think there was a recognition of that. It's just that what happens, you know,
well,
what could happen
I think he should,
going forward.
I can imagine, I can understand that he wishes to for India to move much more than it has. But don't forget, for the reasons that I mentioned earlier, what are the some of the very important components of India-US strategic partnership? And these are not tactical ones. If we want to maintain that and in fact progress that, which is important for our own interests, then what we have to try and do is to see that whatever importance we attach to our relationship with Russia, to our relationship with Iran, that is to the maximum extent is insulated from pressures from the United States. So if we have managed, for example, with respect to say S-400 purchase from Russia, even though it is true that there is still a possibility that there may be sanctions imposed later on, but so far we have managed to deflect that. Similarly, with regard to Iran
and
on
oil.
The oil imports, we have, more importantly for India, the fact that you have been able to continue with the Chabahar project and, you know, the east-west corridor,
right.
Which again, technically speaking, should fall, you know, prey to these sanctions. So I think it, in a way, the strong relationship that we have managed to develop with the United States has also helped us in convincing the United States that, you know, there are other very important reasons and India's
for India to keep engaging
to be
with these
able to do this, and you need to understand. What
but I think the question.
So I don't quite buy the idea that you know we have somehow you know just capitulated to American.
Right, government. But I think the question really is not that India has capitulated, but the fact that the system has now been set up in a way where each time India wants to engage, I mean, these are individual waivers we're talking about. They're individual waivers for how we're going to pay Iran for oil, or individual waivers to purchase the S-400s from Russia. It's not a blanket.
It is not a blanket
waiver.
And it is unlikely that we will be able to get a blanket. What I'm saying is that if you say, I will not accept these individual waivers, you must give me a permanent waiver. Say the United States of America says, sorry,
no.
We will not. What, how are your interests served? I mean, after all, we should be looking at what the alternatives are.
Right.
You know,
okay.
To my mind, even though this is not the best solution possible, but the fact that we are able to get this, you know, and as I mentioned to you, things are changing very rapidly.
Right.
You know, so we have to make certain that as we go forward, what we have identified as key interests for India, we are somehow able to maintain those, that those are not disrupted or those are not,
So, sir, a final theme, because you mentioned age of disruption. One of the disruptions we're seeing across the world is the rise of populist leaders who are fueling identity-driven divisions in society and using those to ride to political power. We are seeing it across the world, the US, India, Indonesia, parts of Western Europe. And again, coming back to the beginning, given that this is an election year, how do we insulate not just foreign policy, but I think our polity and our society from these pressures?
Well, you know, these are kind of movements, or these are kind of phenomena which will have to run their course. I mean, that is what I believe, that it's very difficult to find a one silver bullet to be able to deal with this. So this is likely to be a feature of our international landscape as we go forward.
For some time.
But I certainly also believe that to some extent in India, I think the peak has been passed. That is, we are perhaps now in a, despite this being an election year, and there will be some populist moves as well, but in terms of the important things like communalism or parochialism or ultra-nationalism, I do believe that, you know, the energy behind these kind of phenomena have relatively diminished. And even if you see across the world, the reason why this may not have a very long shelf life is because, are these in fact able to deal with the problems that the world is facing?
Yeah.
Or is Brexit, for example, the answer to Britain's economic challenges, or, you know, the challenges of the new global economy? No. So none of the challenges that we face actually can be resolved through purely national means. You in fact are living in a world where most of the challenges require collaborative global responses. They need some international sense of internationalism, some international spirit. And this is antithetical to what we are seeing. So going forward, it is, I mean, this is a belief that I have, that sooner or later we will have to come back to a better balance between what is legitimate national interest, as well as, you know, what we are able to do as members of a larger international.
Because this sort of, in the context of our neighborhood and regional security, this kind of populism or populist-driven, identity-driven politics we're seeing is having very real consequences.
Yes.
For example, it's having consequences on the immigration and the migration debate from Bangladesh into the Northeast, or whether India will take in more or turn back Rohingya refugees from the country. These are people who are being driven out because of the religion they espouse, not because they might be people in need or might be economic migrants or some other ways, in some other ways threatening you know, security or resources, what have you. It's really driven on the basis of identity. How can we allow ourselves to ride this wave?
Let me just make the point that any political party or parties which, you know, indulge in this kind of narrow identity politics or communal politics has to contend with the fact that there is no particular threshold that you can establish that we will divide this much and no further. Which is the reason why I have argued before that you cannot construct, for example, an overarching Hindu identity on the basis of a Hindu-Muslim binary. Once you start the position of the process of division, where do you say this division is legitimate, but, you know, any further division is not legitimate? You cannot do that. So this is something which is almost by its very nature self-defeating. So what can work in India, in if you look at it logically, is a leadership or a party which is able to, you know, transcend these various divisions, transcend these various barriers.
I think
because
we're a long
only
way from
then
that, though.
You have political success. Well, you know, this is as I said, a phase which will have to run its course.
Yeah.
But I also believe that to some extent, the peak of that phenomena has been passed, and perhaps we are in the repair phase to some extent.
Well, that's an optimistic note to end this conversation on. Ambassador Shyam Saran, thanks so much for speaking to The Wire. Thank you.
To receive instant updates on all videos from The Wire, click the subscribe button and hit the bell icon. Pay to support independent journalism. Click the link in the description and choose the amount you want to pay.